سلام به همگی، خوش اومدید به برنامه نان گل سرخ. من مریم نمازیم
و من فریبرز پویا هستم.
در برنامه این هفته در رابطه با اعتصاب سراسری کامیونداران و رانندگان کامیون صحبت میکنیم و نیاز همبستگی به این اعتصابیون.
اعتصاب سراسری زیباییه که باید مورد همبستگی قرار بگیره. مصاحبه این هفتهمون با ابراهیم عبدالله، بنیانگذار مسلمیش در ایالات متحده است.
فتوای احمقانمون از امام جمعه است که میگه نماز جمعه خیلی مهمه، اگرم نرین خونه رو سرتون خراب میکنن. به به،
آدمای خیلی جالب هستن اینا،
فتواهای احمقانه. و لحظه زیبای زندگیمون از زنان آزاد نویسنده در افغانستانه و فعالیتشون برای اینکه صدای زنان رو به گوش جامعه برسونن و از برابری دفاع کنن. با ما باشید، جای نرین. کامیونداران و رانندگان کامیون الان مدتی که اعتصاب کردن، اعتصابشون سراسریه و میدونیم که این اعتصاب به بیش از 280 شهر گسترش پیدا کرده. واقعا یک چیز عظیمیه و به خصوص وقتی خواسته هاشون رو میبینیم، واقعا خواسته های برحق و خواسته هایی که خواسته تمام جامعه ایرانه.
بیان این اهمیت این اعتصاب نه تنها در سراسری بودنشه و تأثیر اقتصادی رو که روی جامعه ایران و قدرت در واقع بخش کامیوندارا، رانندگان و بخش مهم اقتصادی جامعه ایران نشون میده. وقتی دست به دست هم میدن چه تأثیر مهمی میذاره. خواسته هاشون در این حال که خیلی ساده است، خواست تمام مردم ایران هست، خیلی نزدیکه. گفتن که تمام مافیای اسلامی که توی مراکز باربری و مراکز بارزنی هستن، پایانه هایی که وجود داره تو تمام مناطق، در واقع فشار اقتصادی که روی اینا هست، امکانات حقوق پایین داره که دارن، عدم بیمه و قیمت جنسا که میره بالا، از تایری رو که دارن باید بخرن تحت کنترل دولت و اینا رو تو بازار سیاه باید بخرن و قیمتاش هم بشه اینقدر سرسام آوره که کار میکنن به فقر و بدبختی دارن زندگی کنن، بچه هاشون نمیتونن مدرسه بفرستن به راحتی.
و خب الان میبینیم که این مسئله کل جامعه است. الان میبینیم ریال انقدر افتاده، برای مثال 190 هزار تا بود به یه دلار، الان اخیراً شده به یه دلار. میبینیم که همه کالاها، همه از لاستیکشون گرفته تا همه امکاناتی که لازم دارن برای کارشون چندین برابر شده، هم مثل
توی مدت خیلی کوتاهی.
و این مشکل همه است دیگه، از اینکه میری گوشت میخری تا میری لوازم پوشک میخری برای بچت، همش اینا چند برابر شده و فشار خیلی زیادی داره میاره روی جامعه.
دقیقاً وضعیت مردم رو به جای رسونده که نفس نمیتونن بکشن. شما وقتی وضعیت خطرناک راننده های تریلی های ایران رو میبینین که چطوری با جونشون بازی میکنن، وقتی با لاستیک های میرن که کاملا از استاندارد مینیموم پایین تره و جونشون رو در خطر میذارن، وقتی هم کارشون انجام میدن اون مقداری که دستشون میاد کمتر از اون چیزیه که در واقع حقوقی رو که گرفتن، کمتر از خرجی که دارن میکنن. و نه تنها قیمت ها رفته بالا، بلکه کنترل تمام لوازمی رو که یازن دارن دست مافیای اسلامیه. با باج دادن باید برن بار بزنن، تایر لاستیک میخوان برن تو بازار سیاه و بازار آزاد باید بگیرن که قیمت ها چندین برابره. و نگاه میکنی میبینی که این وضعیت تمام جامعه ایرانه. به این خاطر به شدت سراسری شده. این دفعه سومه که راننده های تریلیا، راننده های کامیون تلاش کردن حقشون رو خواستهاشون رو مطرح بکنن. مسئولین جمهوری اسلامی اصلا بهشون اهمیت ندادن و در واقع هیچ وقعی نذاشتن به خواستای اینا و مجبور شدن که دست به اعتصاب سراسری بزنن و این جامعه ایران رو در واقع کاملا متوجه این وضعیت کرده و خواستشون هم خواسته تمام مردم به ایرانه.
و خب چیزی که واقعا مطرح اینجا یکی از خواسته هاشون مسئله درآمده، که درآمدشون زیر خط فقره، و این یه واقعیت برای خیلی از کسانی که تو ایران کار میکنن، از معلم‌ها گرفته تا غیره. و میبینیم که وقتی که کامیوندارا میگن درد ما درد همه است، درد شماست، دقیقا این یکی از معضلای مهم جامعه است. یا اینکه حقوقا زیر خط فقره، یا اینکه دستمزدا برای ماهای ماه پرداخت نشدن، دستمزدهای معوقه، و این باعث میشه که
همون دستمزدهایی که زیر فقرن برای ماهای ماه نمیدن و با جریمه شون میکنن. یکی از چیزهایی هست که چقدر جریمه سنگین روی روی راننده های تریلی میذارن. این هم بس این هماهنگ بودن و یکسان بودن خواسته ها نقش عظیمی رو به نظر من توی این اعتراض کامیوندارا و راننده ها داشت.
و میتونیم ببینیم که اقشار مختلف در جامعه الان دارن از این اعتصابیون دفاع میکنن، از برای مثال گروه بازنشستگان، گروه های از معلمان و شرکت واحد. و در ضمن در خارج کشور هم میبینیم همبستگیایی شده، چه توی آمریکا کارگران تیمستر برای مثال، یا کارگران تریلی در هلند. میشه دید که الان این به طور وسیع‌تری داره منعکس میشه توی دنیا، و حمایت ها دارن همینجوری میان به طرف کارگران اعتصابی تریلی و راننده.
دقیقا اتحادیه سراسری ترانسپورت دنیا اعلامیه داره در دفاع از خواستای معترضین و اعتصابیون در ایران، و میتونیم ببینیم که و یکی از کارهای ما، وظیفه ما اینه که صدای اعتصابیون رو به تمام دنیا برسونیم و تلاش بکنیم که این همبستگی برای این اعتراض وسیع‌تر باشه، که اونا هم احساس قدرت بتونن بکنن، ببینن که تنها نیستن، نه تنها تو جامعه ایران همه باید کمکشون بکنن، بلکه در سطح بین‌المللی هم باید فشار بذارن روی جمهوری اسلامی که حقوق جامعه ایران، در واقع حقوق جامعه و مردم ایران رو به رسمیت بشناسن.
و خب میشه دید که جمهوری اسلامی خب مشخص سعی کرده اعتصاب شکنی کنه، کاری که همیشه میکنه، تهدید کنه. بیش از 150 تا راننده بازداشت شدن، اینا باید فوراً و بدون قید شرط آزاد بشن. و میبینیم که حتی تهدیدهای مانند این که کسایی که دارن این کارو میکنن بعد اعدامم بشن میشنویم از مقامات جمهوری اسلامی، و میشه دید که چقدر میترسن از این نوع اعتصابات سراسری و این اعتراضات، چون میدونن دقیقاً واقعا جمهوری اسلامی رو داره میلرزونه،
و این نیرویی که میتونه بنیانهای جمهوری اسلامی رو به لرزه در و در واقع تهدیدش میکنه. اینو میدونن به خوبی و اهمیت داره که مورد پشتیبانی قرار بگیرن، و نشون میده که تمام قوانین اسلامی که در مورد صحبت میکنن امروز به کارشون داره میاد که از اون استفاده کنن و مردم رو سرکوب بکنن. صحبت از این میکنن که اینا یاغی هستن، اینا کسایی که اعتصاب کردن جاده ها رو بستن و تلاش میکنن که اجازه ندن کسی توی هیچ تراکتوری و هیچ تریلی یا کامیونی بار نزنه. اینا میگن اینا یاغی هستن و دارن امنیت مردم رو دارن تهدید میکنن، و هر کس امنیت مردم رو تهدید بکنه جرمش جرمه و طبق قوانین اسلام باید کشته بشه. این جوهر جمهوری اسلامیه که حتی نمیتونه تحمل بکنه کسی که زندگیش زیر خط فقره و نمیتونه بچه‌هاشو مدرسه بفرسته، غذا رو روی میز بچه‌هاش نمیتونه بذاره، تهدید به مرگشون کنه. جوهر اسلام و جمهوری اسلامی و قوانین اسلامی همینه.
دقیقاً میبینیم که اعتصاب حرامه از نظر اونا، میبینیم که با استفاده از گزینش خیلی‌ها رو اجازه کار نمیدن، اینکه تبعیض هست، اینکه خط فقر جزو واقعی زندگی خیلی از مردم ایرانه، و اینکه حق اعتصاب، حق اعتراض رو اصلا نادیده میگیره، و حمله و کشتن و زندانی کردن رهبران کارگری و کسانی که اعتراض میکنن، این جزوی از جمهوری اسلامیه.
دقیقا ما خواهان آزادی دستگیر شدگان هستیم، در واقع اینا زندان‌های سیاسی جامعه ایران هستن، بخشی از جامعه زندان سیاسی هستن. خواست کارگران باید آزادی رفقاشون باشه. ما از خواستای رانندگان تریلی و کامیون کاملا پشتیبانی میکنیم و تلاش میکنیم که صداشون رو توی هر جا که امکان داره توی دنیا برسونیم.
یه بخش دیگه هم از کاری که جمهوری اسلامی میکنه، همیشه میندازه گردن دشمن خارجی، در حالی که واقعیت اینه که دشمن مردم ایران، کارگران ایران، همون خود جمهوری اسلامی هن.
اگه اینا مسئول بودن میامدن به خواستای، بررسی میکردن خواسته های رانندگار رو و پاسخ بشوندن،
نه تهدید به اعدام،
نه تهدید به اعدام، بگن مال خارجیه، میخوان اقتصاد رو داغون بکنن، همین حرفا رو میزنن. ولی واقعش اینه که با تمام این تهدیدها راننده ها عقب ننشستن، اعتصابشون و اعتراضشون گسترده و گسترده میشه و هر روز همبستگی بیشتری رو به خودش میکشه.
و این اعتصاب حتما باید در مضمون اعتراضات دیگه ببینیم، اعتصابات دیگه. به زودی روز معلمه و معلمانم فراخوان اعتصاب دادن. میدونیم که کارگران خدمات شهری شهرداری رامشیر اعتصاب دارن، معلمان در بوجنرد و کارکنان بیمارستان امام کرج. این اعتراضات همه اهمیت ویژه‌ای دارن به خاطر اینکه فشار میارن برای یک زندگی دیگه برای کسایی که تو ایران زندگی میکنن.
و مریم، نقش این اعتراضات در واقع و گسترششون و دائمی بودنشون نشون میده نقش مردم رو برای تغییر وضعیت جامعه ایران نشون میده و اهمیت و سنگینی این جنبش رو نشون میده و این نیرویی که میتونه جامعه ایران رو بهبود ببخشه، این نیرویی که میتونه جمهوری اسلامی رو نابود بکنه و این نیرویی که میشه بهش اعتماد کرد، میشه بهش اعتماد کرد. لازم نیست کسی روی جامعه ایران بمب بریزه، تهدید نظامی بکنه، حمله نظامی بکنه،
تهدید اقتصادی بکنه.
مردم ایران هستن که میتونن جمهوری اسلامی رو نابود بکنن، از میان بردارن و آینده بهتری رو برای جامعه ایران نوید بدن.
زنده باد رانندگان و کارگران اعتصابی.
Ibrahim Abdullah, it's a wonderful pleasure to have you on our program. I wanted to speak to you first about the latest Muslimish conference where you presented some of your artwork. Can you tell us a bit about that artwork?
Yes, this year's conference, I presented three pieces. One was related to Islam, one was related to Christianity, and one is like science themed. The first one, I changed the verse, the first verse of the Quran, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق. Read by the name of your Lord that created man from semen. I changed it to write by the name of your mind that created idols from paper. Which I like that piece. It's a beautiful piece. And the piece of wood that I did it on was beautiful too. The second one, I put all the verses of the New Testament that I thought were wrong and are just disgusting, because I hear a lot that people defend Christianity, say like, well, Islam is violent but Christianity is peaceful, and like, no, the Old Testament is violent but the New Testament is peaceful. So here, this is like really bad stuff. It's in the New Testament, so I wanted to make sure that that's there. And then the third piece I really brought up because it's for a friend. She's gonna take it for Iman. It's got chemistry. It's like the periodic table, and I put it the different and carbon. I made like roots coming out of it. It's fun. I like working with wood. It really, my inspiration for that really came from Islam also, because when I first argued with my friends after telling them that I don't believe in the things in Islam, one of the things that I mentioned is that there's a hadith that says before the end of the day the tree is gonna talk. And it's going to tell Muslims where the Jews are so they can kill them. And that part really, when I really believed, I heard it and I didn't stop me. I kept going. But now, once I had started questioning, that really pissed me off. Really, you think a tree is going to talk? And if the tree talks, it's going to tell you to kill someone? Like it's a tree. You think the tree is going to tell you to kill someone? when I first started working with wood, that was my inspiration. Like, let me show you what the tree will say. The tree will not gonna, it's not gonna tell you to kill someone. Trees, you know. So yeah, that was.
Ah, beautiful. Yeah. And so one of the discussions at this conference, it was about the importance of art.
Yes.
And its impact on human society. Can you talk a bit about that? And also, in criticizing things that are inhuman or taboo.
Yes. Well, it really, like, the whole idea of, like, having a conference that is about advancing the sciences and cultivating the arts, that was Jinan's idea, and she always comes up with the best ideas for these things, because we don't want to be just about what we're rejecting or what we're against. We want to be about what we're for. We want to just build a different model, like, start a different, and most of our ethics almost comes from art, It replaces the role that dogma used to, like, play in our lives, and we need to cultivate that. We need to encourage that for people, because it really, like, it completes the human character in a way, and that's why we wanted to, like, focus on art and most of our members here, they have an artistic side. Like, I don't consider myself an artist, but, you know, I just like to, like draw on wood. I like to, like, write things on wood, and it's really because the piece of wood that I'm picking is already beautiful without me touching it. So it's about appreciation for the art, like having something else that to draw beauty from and get these nice feelings that we used to get from religion.
And what's interesting about Muslimish is, first of all, everybody loves the name.
Yeah. You
know, they think it's the greatest name ever. I think too. It's just such a great name, Muslimish.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it also could work Mish Muslim, which is not Muslim. And that's why, like, in our logo, the M is double. So, like, that was one of those, like, little tricky things.
Beautiful.
It can be Mish Muslim, which is not Muslim. Yeah.
And this idea, what's the idea behind this? Because it's got both ex-Muslims and Muslims
Yes.
in it. So it's quite an interesting space to
Yes.
be in.
Yes. And we, well, the idea is if we want to, like, have real change, we need to work with Muslims. I don't think, like, our numbers are really small as ex-Muslims, I think. And most of us don't feel comfortable. I mean, this has been changing. We are more and more, we're having more vocal people. That's definitely happening. But for a lot of people, they can't speak about it. They can't talk about it. They can't. It's good to be able to go to a place where you can be either Muslim or not Muslim. It's safer that way. Also, like, we want to allow a space for, because when I first started, when I first had doubts, there was no place for me to go. There was no place where I can just discuss things with people. And every time I talk to someone about it, they're like, oh, no, that's haram. So, like, there was just no place for discussion, no place where I can explore my ideas. And I felt like we needed that space. It's beautiful because I love it, because it has made me understand a lot about the, like, nuances of how different people think. Some people would call themselves Muslim. They choose to call themselves Muslim. But if you really talk to them, there's a lot of things in Islam they don't agree with. But they choose to call themselves Muslim for whatever reason. I don't care what the reason is. At the end of the day, they are good people morally, and they choose, they make the good choices. They just, they wanna choose Islam because it gives them comfort in one way or another. And that's fine. As long as at the end of the day, you're not beating your wife, you're not, like, giving your son double your daughters, and, you know, like, things like that. It's like, what are you doing in real life? Not because, not just the label that you put on yourself. What are your actions? What are you really doing? So we have, some of these Muslims and our ex-Muslim members, we both agree on a lot of things. We definitely both agree on the necessity of free discussion and the importance of having a space for discussion and getting rid of the laws that prohibit people from exploring their ideas, blasphemy laws. We all, Muslims and ex-Muslims, we agree that these laws are wrong. So Muslims and ex-Muslims, we agree that women, men and women are equal. You know, so we have a lot of common, and we're trying to focus on what's in common so we can work together and achieve common goals. We have discussions, like you just noted, yeah, that there is a lot of disagreement, but we, at least we're having a space where we can have this disagreement. We, at least we have a space where we can have this discussion. So even though for a lot of people, it can be a little bit off-putting, but after, like, I think if you come in meeting or one or two meetings, people start seeing the other person's point of view, and I think we need that. We need to be able to coexist. We need to be able to work together, because Muslims and Ekbers, we come from the same background. We like the same food. We have the same traditions. We enjoy the same things. Our disagreement on the religious issues shouldn't prevent us from working towards goals we both agree on, and that's what we're trying to harness. Is trying to harness change from Muslims and ex-Muslims working together to get common goals achieved.
And just as a final question, tell us a little bit about your background, why you started this group. You did say you had no place to discuss when you were having doubts.
Yes.
But about your doubts and why you've come where you are, why you've organized all these people together.
Well, I grew up in Alexandria, Egypt. I grew up in, in Egypt, you're either Muslim or Christian. There's no choice. And it's in your ID card, it's God lives there, kind of. Like God is everywhere. Like everything you say, half the words have God in them. My name has God in it. So, after moving to the United States and, living here for a while and having a daughter was a big factor for me, having a daughter. Things didn't make sense to me. Understanding evolution, living in New York City, having a membership in the Museum of Natural History, taking my kids there every other weekend, I couldn't, it was, and then there was, I think it was about 2006, 2007, there was the big issue about teaching evolution in schools. I was totally teaching intelligent design in school, and I found myself, even though I still consider myself a believer, against teaching intelligent design, because my understanding of evolution was, and then I asked myself, well, why? I should not be on that side. Technically, I should be for intelligent design, but I'm not. I'm for evolution, because I understand evolution. And once you understand something, you can't go back. There are certain things that, and I just, after a while, I spent about 4 years not believing, but trying to believe, trying to keep my belief, because it was important to me. It was a big part of my character, and I didn't. It was not the easiest process, but I consider myself a pretty like strong person, and I handled it. And at the end of it, I just came to the realization, and I don't believe this. And once I came to that, once I told myself that, it became different. And I didn't announce it to everyone. I didn't tell my friends and tell anyone. But it just it kind of came out during an argument with my friends about inheritance laws, because I live in America, and in America you have to write your will. And I told my friends when I was in Egypt visiting that, I'm going to write my will and I'm going to give my son half and my daughter half. And they all attacked me. They all said there was, but they're all guys. And they all, anyway, they were all men. They don't want their money to be decreased. It's really about money. And that's why it really hurt. It hit home for them. And I didn't say anything when I was in Egypt. When I came back, I started writing about it on Facebook, and I was attacked over and over and over. And I was, kind of burst out and here's what else is wrong. You think this is wrong? Here, this is wrong, and this is wrong, and this is wrong. And women's testimonies of men is wrong. And splitting the moon is wrong, and the sun setting in a well of hot mud is wrong, and this is all wrong. And you guys and I just went off, and I kept doing this for about 3-4 years, and everybody told me, well, you think you're the only one who's right and we're all wrong. You're the only one. You think you're the only one who's right and we're all wrong. And I was like, yeah, I'm the only one who's right, and you're all wrong. I'm right. I don't care that I'm the only one. And then I met someone who thought like me, by chance, in a New York City bar, some Pakistani guy whose name was Muslim, and he told me he didn't believe either, and we just had that best conversation, and I have a very vivid memory of that night. It was an amazing experience. It made me want to meet others. I went to the Reason Rally in D.C. I sought you out. I looked for a group for people, for ex-Muslims in America. There was none, so I looked and I found you, And you helped us start and helped us with your experience and what you've been doing. So it was that's and then you know we like, and that's it. Then, you know, like the group started and you know it was.
And it's taken off, hasn't it?
I wouldn't know if it, I don't want to call it taking off. I mean, it's not up to my expectations yet, but it's definitely doing good. And even for me, sometimes I go to meetings where there's one person. I don't care if that person has never met anyone. Like it's a good conversation. This is like these are people who are like think they're completely alone. They've never met anyone before who thought like them, and they are right. This is the crazy part. You're right, and you have everybody around you tell you you're wrong. That's just very frustrating. So there's something about meeting someone else, like, oh my God, I'm not the only one. I am not the only one. It's just, it's euphoric. It's beautiful.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Maria.
آیت الله سید یوسف طباطبایی نژاد، ایشون
اسم بلند و لایه‌های مختلف مراجع و مراتب هم گذاشته برای خودش که
اسم بلند فتواهای
برای خودش اهمیت پیدا کنه.
زیاد یاره.
این همون یارو بود که در رابطه با خوش شدن زاینده رود این حرفای احمقانه هم زد.
اینا خیلی این ایشون خیلی حرفای احمقانه زدن، ولی اینجا در رابطه با خب خودشون امام جمعه هم هستن و گفتن که نماز جمعه مهمترین نمازه، از هر عید و هر چیز دیگه که تو اسلام هست مهمتره.
رفتن همه اطراف چیزای زندگی مردم مهمتره، فقط
از همه چی
مهمتره.
آره،
یعنی
اینقدر مهمه. میگه که مثلا آیت الله خمینی گفته که امام جمعه آدم داشته باشه چقدر مهمه، هیچی دیگه نداشته باشه تو ایران، فقط امام فقط نماز جمعه داشته باشه همه چی درست میشه، همه چی خوبه.
الان هیچی ندارم و... فقط
نماز جمعه
رو ران چیز میکنه.
دقیقاً همین کار کردم. بعد خب جالب اینه که اول با این حرفای مثلا خیلی مثلا توضیح میده که چقدر چیز خوبیه، چقدر اهمیت داره، بعد میگه که هر کی که برای 3 هفتم شده بی‌اعتنایی کنه و نره نماز جمعه، خونش بر رو سرش خراب بشه.
3 هفتم شد.
سه هفته دیگه تهدیدا شروع میشه.
اینا چقدر چیز هستن. خیلی جالبه تو همین صحبت رو که کرده گفته که احترام برای مراجع، منظورش خودش ها، مراجع و معصوم،
یعنی نگران نباش، احترام زیادی هم براتون نداریم، ولی خب
اینا باشه. این خب به خاطر اینکه از طرف خدا و رابطهشون به خوب به خداست. ولی آدم نباید به انسان احترام بذاره، به هیچ انسانی. اگه کسی طرفدار انسان و انسانیت باشه، نه، این بدترین اشتباهی کرده که دوزنی، یعنی که اینا مستقیم ضد انسانه. میگه فقط منو دوست داشته باشین، من فقط فرهنگش اینه. این هر حرفی رو که میزنه، هر فتوایی میده، واقعا احمقانه است. یعنی همش با یه خورده مثلا
زنان آزاد نویسنده سازمانیه که در افغانستان برای چند سال الان فعالیت میکنه و نوشته 140 تا زن رو منتشر کرده.
خیلی خیلی قشنگ و زیباست. بخشی از نوشته هاشون در رابطه با تاثیر برخورد با زنان تو جامعه افغانستان، با سعی میکنن که توضیح بدن که زنان چه احساسی دارن تحت فشار و به طور مرتب تحت آزار و اذیت قرار میگیرن. از زبان خودشون دارن میگن و بخشی از کمپینشون بوده که میرن توی به جاهای مختلف میرن و سعی میکنن که کتاباشون رو و موضوع رو توی جامعه ببرن و در موردش با همه آدمای توی خط و توی خیابون بحث و گفتگو کنن.
بله، مثلا یکی از کمپیناشون اینه که جلوی زن آزاری در خیابونا رو بگیرن و یه نوشته‌ای رو چاپ کردن که دارن میرن و پخش میکنن بین مردانی که تو خیابونن و دارن بهشون توضیح میدن که مشکل با زن آزاری چیه. و در ضمن یه کمپین دیگه هم دارن در رابطه با حق دختران به رفتن به مدرسه و اینکه بذار برن مدرسه، اسم کمپینشونه.
نسل جدید زنان افغانستان اون نیرویی که جامعه افغانستان رو تغییر میده و بهبود میده. این ما رو میاره به پایان برنامه این هفته. تا هفته آینده از طرف من و
مریم خداحافظ.
Goodbye.
Hi, I'm Mariam Namazi.
And I'm Fadi Bospuya.
We're hosting a program called Bread and Roses. It's a weekly program that's broadcast in Persian and English in the Middle East and North Africa, primarily Iran as well. And it's also shown on YouTube internationally.
And we've been doing this since last May. We're coming up to our year's anniversary. And yeah. We've had quite a lot of fun making these videos.
We discuss taboo-breaking, free-thinking ideas. The Islamic regime of Iran has called us immoral and corrupt.
And that's why you need to support us. We are and the alternative voice in Middle East and North Africa.
Of corruption and immorality. So do support us. Here's a short video from Patreon that explains how you can help us with even just $1 a week. That's nothing. Support us.
Patreon lets fans become patrons of their favorite artists and content creators. It's different than Kickstarter because it's not about one big project that requires lots of funding. It's more for bloggers or YouTubers or webcomics, anyone who creates on a regular basis. Here's how it works. When you become a patron, you're agreeing to give an artist a tip of an amount you set every time they release a piece of content, whether it's a new song, a video, or a recipe. You can set a monthly maximum to make sure that you're always within your budget. Choose an amount, enter your payment information, and you're done. Becoming a patron allows you to view and post in the artist's stream, and in exchange for your support, artists offer additional patron packages, which might include monthly Google Hangouts, music production tutorials, pre-sale concert tickets, or anything they can offer as a way to say thanks. Patreon, empowering a new generation of content creators.